Kyle Sonlin and Herwig Konings are founding partners of Security Token Group. All opinions expressed by them or guests on this podcast are solely their opinions and do not represent the views of Security Token Group or its subsidiaries. You should not take any opinion expressed on the show as a specific inducement to make a particular investment or follow any investment strategy. This podcast is for informational purposes only.
And thank you for tuning in to episode 82 of the Security Token Show. We're coming to you from our studio in sunny Miami, Florida. I'm your host, Herwig Konings, and of course, I'm joined by my co-host and business partner, Kyle Sonlin. And if you're tuning in for the first time, you should know that the show's programming starts out with a segment covering last week's industry news, followed by an update of the newest security token offerings and a report of the secondary market trading activity.
That's right. And then we're going to finish off the show with our weekly main topic discussion, which this week is going to focus on how real estate assets can be tokenized and used as collateral to take out a loan in a much simpler and efficient manner. But of course, we can't get started without first doing our Company of the Week awards, where we award two companies for making the biggest moves in the industry over the last week. Who's your pick, Herwig?
Well, Kyle, last year I actually wrote the article that you might remember about the rising security token scene in Japan. You know, maybe it's due to, you know, for an update actually, probably, but I did acknowledge in that post a wave of innovation that was uniquely spreading into Japan's financial ecosystem. And, you know, you can go check that out on our Medium blog anytime you want for your own time. But, you know, for now, I want to hone on one specific company that was already making waves back then. You know, shockingly, they haven't quite ever made the cut for winning Company of the Week, but that time has ended, folks. Japanese investment bank SBI is winning my Company of the Week. The spin-off firm from SoftBank, which now trades in the billions on the Tokyo Stock Exchange and now has over 8,000 employees, has aggressively pushed its way into security tokens since 2019 and now has made two major announcements in the last week. They officially commemorated a partnership with a London Stock Exchange group to plug into for their digital exchange that they actually are developing in Osaka and is expected to launch in 2022, for those of you even listening along the show. And the firm has similarly put relationships already in the past with other jurisdictions, including in Singapore, Germany, and Switzerland, both with a partnership there with SIX, the Swiss International Exchange, and also through last week announcing that the firm invested $10 million in Signum Bank, which actually tokenized its shares back in December last year. So presumably making the transaction easier for them altogether, and actually also brings Signum's total raise to $30 million for their round. So SBI is clearly building a global gateway and plans to power it with security tokens, and it's putting its money where its mouth is. So for all those reasons, Kyle, SBI wins my Company of the Week.
That's fantastic. There's really no better choice, I think, than SBI. They've done so much tremendous work investing in innovation all around the world, really helping to build what we've been talking about here on the show for, I mean, since episode one, which is building that interoperability across jurisdictions, around the world, across asset classes, all of this stuff. It all should be tied together. It's the beauty of security tokens and blockchain technology is that we can standardize these assets around the world and no matter what that asset is. And so SBI is really paving the way in that front and using its main value add, which is that clout, as well as that capital that they have as an investment bank, one of the largest in the world. And it's nothing short of incredible what they've been up to.
Now, thanks, Kyle. I appreciate that choice there. I want to hear what you got.
So my Company of the Week this week is the newest marketplace to enter the security token space. And based out of Israel, Simetria was just recently awarded a no-action letter by the Israel Securities Authority, allowing them to allow private companies to tokenize their securities and allow Israeli as well as global accredited investors to invest in the deals. On top of that, Simetria added that it has also requested a permit that would allow it to settle digital securities using distributed ledger technology, which would be amazing if it's allowed, because remember, even here in the US, they're still not fully cleared to do that yet. So for trailblazing in the super hot tech scene, which is Israel, as they've been a hub now for a while in terms of pioneering a lot of great tech, on top of planning to launch their marketplace, that primary issuance platform, as early as May 2021, I'm absolutely thrilled to award Simetria my Company of the Week for episode 82.
Well, that's fantastic as well, Kyle. You know, the startup nation Israel won't be far behind in security tokens as per your choice right here. The regulators are on board. We know the Tel Aviv Stock Exchange is also very active and exploring technology, and now Symmetria. So that's fantastic.
And it's headed by a pioneer in the security token space, Ami Ben David. Shout out to him for a lot of the work he's done on the blockchain side. He was very closely working with Spice VC back in the day. Now he's working on this, and you couldn't be in better hands for somebody that's been in the industry.
Also running Onera, one of the private blockchains built purpose for security tokens, and presumably what Symmetria will be using for their platform.
So with that, Herwig, I think we can transition right into the industry news.
Let's do it. Now, before I do, of course, I want you all to know that, you know, the articles we cover on this show, they're all sourced from stomarket.com/news, and they're also available for reference in the about description of the podcast from wherever you're listening to, or always on the Security Token Show Medium blog whenever you want to read the news for yourself. Now, last year I mentioned that China's central bank digital currency would become the largest adopted CBDC in the world given its fast-growing adoption across the country. And now there has been another innovation for the currency, the ability to convert physical currency to virtual currency using ATMs and also vice versa. So an interesting option to enable flexibility between both currency types. So now 8 ATMs in Beijing are helping Chinese citizens leverage digital yuans, certainly a sign that the CBDC is here to stay in the country. And over in the U.S., we saw the former head of digital assets for TD Ameritrade be named the Fed's chief innovation officer. So Sunanya Tuteha's team oversaw and developed the crypto services and products at the bank. And in the past, she's even said she's a Bitcoiner herself. So it's safe to say we can expect blockchain to be part of the Fed's innovation agenda. And seeing as we were just talking about a Chinese CBDC, I think I know where this might be headed. And to catch up with the Ripple versus SEC case, where the firm allegedly sold $1.5 billion in unregistered securities with its XRP coin sales, an article headlined on Fortune recently said that the former SEC chair Mary Jo White, who by the way oversaw the tenure during the creation of the Jobs Act, says that the SEC is, quote, dead wrong about its case against the firm. Now, what that headline doesn't actually say there, and probably I think should, is that Mary Jo White is actually the attorney right now representing Ripple in the case. So, you know, take it with a grain of salt, I would say. But mostly she cried foul at the case's timing and that the current regulation was like pegging a square in a round hole. Ultimately, she cried for regulatory clarity on the matter from the new chair. And needless to say, you know, as the SEC continues now into its discovery phase with the case, it's likely neither side will settle, at least not until October, according to her. And moving into company announcements, we start off with a bit of a peculiar one. This one raises eyebrows due to the size of the commitments in the announcement. A supposed 100,000 bitcoins, that's right, bitcoins, billions of dollars worth, has been pledged for the city of Miami's blockchain strategy, you know, in the form of an organization by Dubai's IBC Group, International Blockchain Consulting Group. Now, Kyle and I find this amazing news, obviously, since we live here in Miami. The article talked about, you know, the efforts to leverage blockchain in all kinds of different capacities for the city's government that Mayor Francis Juarez has been talking a lot about in the past. But of course, seeing as the fact that it wasn't really reciprocated here by any major outlets or the mayor himself, there's a chance that this may not be legitimate or credible at all. So until we learn more, we're just going to move on.
Miami Tech, though, for the win.
Absolutely. Now, we do have a few new players coming into the industry. The first is in South Korea, where a mobile phone company, Kakao, plans to introduce security tokens via Ground X. So Ground X will use the blockchain they developed, Clayton, to store and verify private securities on the blockchain in over-the-counter trades using their partner QuotaBook. So the article says that, quote, the partnership aims to open up a new dimension of trading by allowing its users to purchase shares of unlisted startups and maintain the records of these transactions, end quote. So that's exciting news for Korean investors, as some of the earlier security token platforms coming onto the scene there. And the second platform coming to market is TAP here in the U.S., created by Crypto Asset Rating Inc., the tokenized asset platform, or TAP, is designed to help small and medium-sized businesses in the U.S. raise funds using all kinds of tokenized instruments, from equities to bonds to convertible notes and even into funds. So looks like it's an all-encompassing platform ready to compete in the now fast-growing tokenization industry here in America. And finally, we have U.S. issuance platform Vertalo making an announcement that 5 new regulation crowdfunding portals have been added as clients. So the 5 platforms are Fundopolis, Funders USA, InfraShares, NetShares, and Raise Green. So the firms, you know, they'll be using Vertalo's transfer agent services. They're API driven, and they, of course, would support tokenization. So I think it's a great step in the right direction for potential future tokenized Reg CF offerings, hopefully. So great job, Vertalo team. And finally, moving into our resources and opinion articles from last week, we start with an article on BlockTelegraph explaining why blockchain would help trade securities instantly instead of settle in days. We cover this in our main topic on episode 79 of the show in the past, which you can catch just the clip of it on YouTube if you want to check it out on top of this great article breaking it down. And next, we have the CEO of Neufund, which is also based out of Germany, Zoe Adamovich, taking things a step further and breaking down the whole online investment process for crowdfunding platforms using the blockchain on Crowdfund Insider there. So it's not quite a step-by-step analysis, but she does talk about the benefits and all the success that they've had with their STOs like Grape. So check it out if you're interested. And good old Peter Gaffney with the Tokenized This Weekly series on Medium has released week 6, tokenizing website content. So how does it work? As he says it, quote, rather than structuring the tokens to offer a direct investment, a website owner can now structure the tokens to carry IP rights for advertising on the site. Each token can have a specified time slot, advertisement side, content focus, and other points baked into them via smart contracts based on the desired criteria. So another potential fascinating use case worth checking out about, you know, it's there on Medium if you're curious. And finally, with an op-ed from law firm Gibson Dunn talking about the new priorities of the Biden administration when it comes to banking, fintech, and derivatives. So specifically, they say President Biden's choices to head the OCC, the SEC, and the CFTC will have significant input into the regulation of digital assets and fintech, specifically with certain Trump-era regulations likely being subject to re-examination. So there's that and a whole lot more in general about the upcoming potential political changes in the landscape. And that's the full rundown from last week for you all, Kyle. You know, any industry webinars and events coming up?
Awesome work, as always, Herwig. And we do have some interesting events this week. First off, I want to remind everybody that last week we actually hosted our second Clubhouse breakout session. So on Thursdays at 5 p.m., we break down our main topic and last week's episode, which was centered around NFTs, digital art, and security tokens. We really covered that in great detail. And so we had a rock star panel with securities attorneys like Mark Golditch and Nisa Moyles weighing in on their opinions on whether digital art and collectibles should be considered securities by the SEC. We also had great panelists like Alon Gorin from Draper Gorin Holm, Matthew Unger from iComply, Bruce Fenton from Watchdog Capital, the Crypto Twins, Mason Borda from Tokensoft, as well as seed investor and recently crowned unicorn NFT issuer Dapper Labs, and that is Alexander Bulkin. On top of that, thanks to Jacob Sparks from Akimona and a few of our other Q&A participants for asking the panel great questions. I gotta say, it was fantastic. It was a tremendous chat. Very interesting to hear from so many different perspectives on this one. We talked to lawyers, we talked to NFT issuers and enthusiasts, we talked to issuance platforms, we talked to investors. It was just a really, really good time. Herwig and I had a blast. Shout out to Keith for doing awesome job on the moderation there. And so you can tune in every week to our Clubhouse breakout sessions at 5 p.m. on Thursdays. We're going to be doing another one in just a couple of days.
It was a great time. I even had one listener follow up with me and say they plan to buy a CryptoKitty. So a very relevant conversation. It was a very fun time. Looking forward to the next one.
And then finally for events, we have Draper Gorin Holm's newest blockchain and booze happy hour, which is actually going to be featuring the mayor of Miami, Francis Suarez, who has made headlines as an incredibly blockchain and tech-friendly leader of the U.S. government official here in Miami. And he's going to be joining Alon Gorin and the team on Tuesday at 5 p.m. Pacific time. You definitely got to check this one out. It will be coming out as of the day of publishing. But that's about it for events and webinars we had this week. As a reminder, you can submit any of those to us directly or on stomarket.com/news so that we can cover it on the show. And with that, I think I can bounce right into security tokens.
Let's get to that STO report. What do you got?
Well, in security token offering news, we have a pretty crazy update from Lottery.com. And so Auto Lotto, the company behind Lottery.com's security token offering, is officially SPACing onto NASDAQ. With a post-merger valuation of over $500 million, the company will trade later this year under the ticker LTRY. And according to the Seeking Alpha article that I was referencing for research, Lottery.com has been named one of the largest providers of lottery data. They provide that to Powerball, Mega Millions, and over 400 other publishers. customers. And lottery's been growing pretty strong. Gross revenue is up, I think, 300%+. And now they're expecting around $71 million in revenue in 2021, as well as, you know, it's going to go up from there. Now, you might be wondering how that translates into value for the security token investors of lottery.com. And the short answer is that it doesn't appear to. Despite the fact that lottery.com's stockholders will roll 100% of their equity into the combined company, holders of the LDCC security token are actually not equity holders. At the time of the fundraise in 2017, the token offered investors 7% of the net revenue on a planned global impact raffle, which was aiming to gamify the way that traditional charities, sports franchises, and others raised funds. According to the company, the platform was designed to generate significant prizes for players and while supporting the fundraising goals for critical humanitarian causes. Sounds great. However, much to the chagrin of investors and analysts alike, this raffle never happened. Not only that, but neither the firm nor its executives have acknowledged the token in what seems like years. Their website for the security token is still live at sto.lottery.com, but absolutely nothing has changed in years, and we have heard nothing from anyone since. The only update we've really had on the lottery.com token front is that last year, Open Finance Network, where it's trading, announced that they had successfully leveraged Rule 144 to allow U.S. retail investors to buy and sell shares of this LDCC token, which came as a big surprise since the firm really has done nothing in terms of updates and has tiny volume. And to date, it's still really the only token that's trading on OFN that has enabled retail investment, which is, you know, interesting. Despite the additional access for investors, it has really only led to massive dumps that has seen the price crash over 90% since its initial placement in 2019. So none of this is financial advice, but I do think that this news is pretty bearish for the lottery.com asset. But it does bring serious questions for investors who may feel kind of hard done by this fundraise, because it seems like a lot of empty promises at this point, and I've reached out multiple times to as many people on that team as I can with no answer from them. So certainly if anybody's listening, let's reach out and clear the air here and figure out when this global raffle is going to be launching. But interesting stuff. Lottery.com will be trading on the NASDAQ. And moving into new security token offerings, we have a new one from Stalker, the Luxembourg-based issuance platform behind the Infinite Fleet security token offering, that video game issuance company that we talked about for a couple episodes, as well as the Art ID security token offering, which was successfully closed. And this time, Italian car manufacturer Mazzanti is fundraising to build the Millecavalli R, a supercar that has been 20 years in the making. The firm has produced about 15 production cars in the past because they specifically focus on track and performance cars in very limited supply. The firm is currently seeking to raise $1 million to fund the development of a single car, which token holders will receive 50% revenue share on the sale of that specific car once it's finished. It's a pretty interesting model, as it seems like a much shorter investment cycle than what you would traditionally expect from like an equity investment or something like that. And I wasn't really able to find any projections on their past car sales or what the demand looks like for this specific brand of supercar. But the firm, as I said, has been operational for over 20 years, and they do seem to bring some automotive expertise from Italy. So it's a very interesting deal, and it again kind of opens that door for other issuers to explore the use case of single product fundraises to de-risk those, you know, hefty R&D upfront costs. So other examples might include biotech or the film production industry, which we've seen examples of in the past, which also have those high upfront costs for a single product. So if you want to check out more there, go to stalker.io to hear more and read more about the company.
That's pretty cool. I mean, from a interesting perspective, if it costs you $500,000 to build a car and they can flip it for $1 million and it, you know, they can do all that in 4 to 6 months, doubling your money, pretty good deal. If they can do that. So awesome.
Absolutely. And we've talked about in the past how I'm not a huge fan oftentimes of revenue share or profit sharing, just because, you know, in a lot of cases, it seems like that's just less value for the investor. But in this case, especially when it's on one specific product that they're just looking to sell, it does seem like a very efficient method for them to raise capital for that product. So
I've totally
agree.
Supercars sell in the millions. So it's not all out of the question to absolutely raise money for this type of a product.
And moving right into our market update segment, we have a few reports to cover before breaking down the trading activity from the week. And so to kick it off, Security Token Markets head of marketing Jonah Shulman released a fantastic research report comparing the security token industry and the secondary market for that, as well as comparing that to the U.S. public stock market. So first starting with the Dow Jones, and then also looking at the performance of a hypothetical security token index versus the NASDAQ over the year 2020. And the results we found were fantastic to compare these assets as a hedge against the traditional markets, as many of these assets, namely some of the hedge funds and tokenized real estate, actually seem to be negatively correlated to the U.S. public market. So some tokens like Overstock and T0 seem to be much closer in correlation, which is to be expected considering their more institutional products, and Overstock itself is actually trading on NASDAQ as well as trading on the security token markets. Which brings up another interesting question of maybe comparing the correlation between the public shares of Overstock and the tokenized shares versus the public markets to see the differences. But the article has a great tone to it. It's fun to read. And Jonah's diving into all this detail. I really recommend you checking this one out if you're into trading, if you're looking at these markets as a potential alternative investment. And the final report we have this week also comes from Security Token Market, this time analyzing the tokenized real estate market over the month of January 2021. Over the month, the total market cap for real estate was up about 5% in equity appreciation, but it was very interesting to see that this market cap growth did not actually come from the largest market cap assets. It was many of those smaller Uniswap properties that were performing well that drove the growth. Many of the smaller assets grew in market cap, and that boosted the overall market cap of the entire industry for real estate. And you can check out that detailed breakdown in the report in the description or subscribe to our newsletter for more great content. You can find that at newsletter.stomarket.com. And as always, as we transition into the secondary market performance, all news and pricing data is sourced from stomarket.com. You can find it all there. And the total STO market cap was down slightly, dropping about 5% to $640 million, which is still really, really strong. Remember, before we broke the all-time high market cap just last week, we haven't seen the $600, $650 million range for months. So we're super happy in this range, and it does seem to be that the hype is there. But there wasn't a ton of activity this week. T0 and Overstock were both down a little bit, which led to that decline in the overall market cap. There were some interesting little notes to point out, including Startup Bootcamp, which is trading on an exchange based out of Amsterdam. And that's seen some increased activity, which is interesting. We've seen it a couple days in a row have some trades, as that's something that we really haven't seen from a consistent activity perspective since its listing over a year ago. And aside from that, we did see a crazy price bounce from one of our newest tokenized real estate properties, 18900 Mansfield Drive. The property has been trading for a few months now, but we've only recently been able to pull the trading data from Uniswap. But yet it saw a crazy price jump this week from $60 to over $86 in just one trade, where an investor purchased 5 shares directly from Uniswap, which totally skewed the market. So remember that with Uniswap liquidity, the price changes based off of how much an asset it has staked in that underlying liquidity pool. And especially with these realty assets, which have very low supply, the price can really rubber band like this in very extreme levels in the short term. So that being said, the prices have held strong over the long term, which suggests that despite that short-term volatility, the model is actually pretty efficient at finding that price discovery for an asset by leveraging competitive markets. It's going to be very interesting to see where the price goes from here.
Well, I mean, despite the drop, it seems like things are pretty healthy. As you said many times in the past, Kyle, I think the market is definitely still yearning for some additional assets to trade. I know we are. And that would definitely inject some fresh new capital and enthusiasm into the system.
Indeed. It's yet another week in the markets on the books, but now I think it's time to transition into our main topic.
I think a fun one today, a novel use case for why, once again, security tokens are a tremendous tool. Tokenizing real estate to collateralize for a loan. So many homeowners and investors have tons of value locked up in equity, and they are dependent on lenders to provide a loan against that real estate. Assessing the value of a property can be tedious and costly, and performing a transaction can be fairly slow and manual. So simply put, digitizing and tokenizing real estate enables lenders and borrowers to instantly transact with each other.
So let's break that down further, Herwig. So for the investor, the benefits are being able to leverage an asset that they normally couldn't get borrowing terms for, or perhaps just not very efficient and certainly expensive terms. A marketplace for lenders can make this efficient, and a digital marketplace means more borrowing options and better terms. For lenders, they can assess the market value of the real estate based on the security token and use programmatic management to force liquidation or ownership control in the case of a default. Not to mention the entire process is digital and it can be set up to be automatic, removing any human capital required.
Yeah, I mean, we could go even further with the on-chain data there, you know, of the asset, which can help with the lender's ability to automatically offer a loan. Things like when the property was last appraised, its trading history, perhaps rental information and building information, all of which can help more lenders offer terms because they know more about the underlying asset thanks to that blockchain information. And for the investor, once again, better terms and options for use of their asset. And they could get paid out in other crypto assets or securities or simply fiat stablecoin options. So incentives can even programmatically be layered in to promote on-time payments. Honestly, the options are endless.
Don't even get us started on building a digital credit identity on that. I mean, that's a whole new can of worms, something super exciting, and I know we're going to see in the future. But how about we talk about maybe some real-world use cases of this? I mean, one of the pioneers in the security token space to take advantage of real estate lending is Reino. That's R-E-I-N-N-O. And they first introduced this idea when they launched their marketplace last year, offering investors in the commercial real estate tokens that they were selling a 50% loan-to-value ratio for their investment during that one-year lockup period, which means that they couldn't trade it, and therefore they could not get liquidity traditionally, offering this great opportunity.
So basically, for a $100,000 investment, you could immediately get $50,000 and use that however you like, maybe invest more in Reino. But really, that's fantastic. And you know the types of benefits that are simply not capable of being offered today in this way.
Yeah, absolutely. This is just one of the many reasons why security tokens just have so much future potential. I mean, we have some more examples, like with Aspen Coin. You've got the tokenized St. Regis Hotel in Aspen, Colorado. And as I covered on last week's episode, those tokens are now actually able to be used as loan collateral with BlockFi, allowing users to stake their current investment, which is on the secondary market, in exchange for leverage to be used on the BlockFi platform, presumably paid in Bitcoin, Ethereum, or the other supported cryptos on that platform. And it's a very innovative solution that begins to bridge that gap between cryptocurrencies and security tokens, as well as leveraging that blockchain for the real benefits there.
Now, one final example that I can also think of is with Realty. I know that they've announced a partnership with decentralized lending protocol OV and working on supporting others so they can leverage the power of DeFi for their real estate tokens with Realty. So this creates powerful market mechanics, I think, and they'll improve the liquidity and financial access for real estate as a whole.
Now, this is really bleeding edge stuff here, listeners. I hope you appreciate the impact of removing the need for human analysis of assets and creation of loan documents, as well as removing a lot of the management and servicing costs that enable lenders to give better rates to borrowers who use tokenized real estate. It's really a great new feature for investors in real estate funds, properties, and even homeowners.
And I think we could probably go on and on with this topic and still not cover some of the innovation that will probably be expanded upon this. So with that, Kyle, do you have anything else to add for our listeners?
Nope, I don't think so. I think we're just on the cutting edge of this stuff. We're really going to see this expand exponentially in the future. But I think it's time to close out this week's show for now, Herwig. It's another great episode. Thank you all for listening. Please send in any questions or feedback to us on Twitter or LinkedIn. And be sure to get the latest trading data and news at stlmarket.com.
Thanks for listening. If you are on Clubhouse, be sure to join us this Thursday at 5 p.m. for the breakdown of the show. And if not, I'll catch you all on Tuesday next week for episode 83. Meanwhile, happy tokenizing.